spoke the word of God to you. Consider how their lives ended and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teaching. It is good to have our hearts strengthened by the grace of God and not by foods which are useless to those who take them as a standard for living. We have an altar from which those who serve the tabernacle have no right to eat. The bodies of the animals whose blood is brought into the sanctuary by the high priest as a sin offering are burnt outside the camp. Therefore, Jesus died outside the gate to sanctify the people by his own blood. Let us go to him outside the camp, bearing the insult which he bore. For here we have no lasting city. We are seeking one which is to come. Through him, let us continually offer God a sacrifice of praise. That is the fruit of lips which acknowledge his name. Do not neglect good deeds and generosity. God is pleased by his sacrifices of that kind. Of God, the Lord has spoken and summoned the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Before him his righteous ones who have made a covenant with him by sacrifice.
Father, give me glory at your side, the glory I had with you before the world. celebrated Pentecost Sunday, commemorating the descent of the Holy Spirit and the birthday of the Church. The following week, we celebrated the Sunday of All Saints, which commemorated the men and women who, throughout the history of the Church to the present day, lived lives and did works that are the fruits of the Holy Spirit. Today, we commemorate the Sunday of the Fathers, the six ecumenical councils, who overspanned many years, approximately 300 years, met, prayed, discussed, and even debated what ultimately came to become a consensus as to what, precisely what, Jesus revealed to us during his earthly ministry. Some of the more important doctrinal issues that perhaps we take for granted that the fathers of the councils resolved were an affirmation of both the humanity and the divinity of Christ, an affirmation of the unity of his divine and human nature. The fathers also upheld the divinity of the Holy Spirit. They defined the Blessed Virgin, Our Lady, as the Theotokos, the God-bearer. Up until that time, these questions were in dispute. These are fundamental and crucial doctrines. Doctrines that cut to the core of today's gospel reading from John, where Jesus prayed to his Father for his disciples, those who knew and followed him. He prayed, because they are yours, and everything of mine is yours, and everything of yours is mine, and I have been glorified in them. Now, there is in this prayer an expression of that perfect love between Father and the Son, and each of them for us. And like that love, that perfect love between the Father and Son, Jesus wants us to love him and his Father, and to love one another. And we hear this as Jesus prayed, Holy Father, keep them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one just as we are. This should give us chills, that they may be one, just as we are. Jesus' desire for us to be as one with one another, just as he is one with his Father. He wants us to walk together with him to the Father, through the power and gentle guidance of the Holy Spirit. Now, the past 2,000 plus years shows that this is much easier said than done. In each generation, since that first Pentecost Sunday, Christians have been tempted to be, as the writer of Hebrews said today, carried away by all kinds of strange teaching. To be carried away from this life in Christ. From which we were baptized. And it's the same Christ that Hebrews says is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Carried away to be torn apart from Christ and his mystical body. When this happens, the Word of God becomes lost, distorted, or simply not heard. And still, in each generation to the present day, there are some who hear that word of God in sacred tradition without distortion and embrace it to discover how Jesus is asking them to live their unique life in Christ and respond to the needs of the times in which they live. Consider three persons who were able to do this in the 20th century. Blessed Pavel Goyevich was a Brazilian monk who was appointed and ordained bishop of Prussia. The good bishop defended the Ruthenian people against Slovak nationalists. He also openly spoke out in support of the Jewish people and actually sent a letter to be read in all his parishes condemning the discriminatory treatment of Jews, and later wrote a formal letter of protest against the deportation of Jews. He also helped refugees and persons incarcerated in concentration camps. Bishop Goyevich did so much to help the Jewish people that he is recognized by the Jews as being righteous among the nations. He died of cancer in 1960 while serving a sentence in prison for high treason. In 2001, he was beatified by the Catholic Church, and he's one step away from sainthood. Professor Elizabeth Anscombe was a philosopher and a devout Catholic, a wife and mother of seven. She loved to have lengthy conversations with friends who held various viewpoints. They would agree on some things, disagree on others, and she always held to her convictions. She made her more conservative friends squirm when she publicly opposed World War II, nuclear arms, President Truman, the Vietnam War. And then she made her more liberal friends squirm when she publicly opposed abortion, supported the dignity of all life from conception to natural death, and openly discussed the virtue of chastity. And yet they always remained friends. Professor Anscombe insisted that her faith, supported by her study in philosophy, inform and shape her positions on these difficult and often divisive issues. Her relentless pursuit of the truth grounded in her love of Christ attracted people to her. And how about Private Desmond Doss? He was a conscientious objector during the Second World War. He was Christian, not Catholic, Christian nonetheless. He refused to bear arms at any point during his enlistment, even during basic training. Private Doss was tormented by his training sergeant, his commanding officer. He was scorned, ridiculed, and on one occasion beaten, physically beaten, by other soldiers, all because he refused to bear arms. He eventually received an exemption from weapons training from a brigadier general so that he was able to serve as an army medic during the war. And while in Japan, he rescued men during the Battle of Okinawa by lowering each one by rope down a cliff to safety. He always carried with him a small Bible in his breast pocket. After each rescue that he made during that battle, prayed a very simple prayer. Lord, help me get one more. And he did get more. 75 in total. The story of Private Doss's selfless and courageous actions is told in the film Hacksaw Ridge. After he risked his life to save 75 others, including his commanding officer, Captain Cook, Private Doss was seen in a very different light. Captain Glover had this to say to Private Doss after he was saved. He said, "All I saw was a skinny kid. I didn't know who you were. You've done more than any other man could have done in the service of this country. I've never been more wrong about someone in my life. I hope one day you can forgive me." What a sincere, humble expression of remorse and a desire for reconciliation. Captain Glover went on and said, "Most men do not believe the same way you do. But they believe so much in how much you believe. What you did on that ridge is nothing short of a miracle. And they want a piece of it." Very powerful words from a man who once scorned and cursed his Private Doss. "But they believe so much in how much you believe, they want a piece of it." I would submit to you that the soldiers saw the light of Christ in this skinny kid who simply loved Christ, trusted him, and looked to him to be a model for his life. And these men he had saved wanted a piece of what this skinny kid had. I think that's what happens when we truly evangelize. So what do these three people all have in common? Blessed Pavel Goidich, Elizabeth Ansco, Desmond Doss, all had a faith in Jesus Christ and knew him to be fully human and fully divine. They were active participants in the mystical body, the church, by seeking to do the will of the Father in their lives and circumstances as revealed by the truth of Christ. I think today, more than ever, we need to learn turn to Jesus in Scripture and to the teachings of his mystical body, the Church. The bishops of the Church, guided by the Holy Spirit, continue to teach us, bringing the truth and light of Christ to contemporary issues in marriage and family life, about the sanctity and dignity of life as they relate to end-of-life issues, capital punishment, abortion, refugees, war, social unrest, care for the environment, and business ethics. My prayer for us is that we all ask the fathers of the councils for their intercession as prayed in Vespers for this feast. We beseech you, the fathers, to intercede for us, preserving us from heresy and error and keeping our lives blameless in God's sight. And as we are instructed in the letter to Hebrews today, may we continually offer God a sacrifice of praise by confessing his name, doing good, and sharing what we have. Glory to Jesus Christ.
Glory to God.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
remember the noble and ever to be remembered fathers and benefactors of this holy church. May he remember in his blessed memory the soul of his departed servant, the high priest, Bishop Milan, and grant him rest for the light of his many times. May the Lord God also accept our own private prayers and petitions that we call to mind and give to him this day. May our Lord God hear your private prayer and grant every petition most helpful to peace and to salvation. May the Lord God attend to the needs of all those who are sick or suffering or in hospitals and all those who need his great mercies. And all you Christians of the true faith always, now and ever on, forever.
Oh.
Day. It's always the Lord's Day. There's something special for yourself this day. You're starting off the right way, starting off with prayer. So I'd like to remind you to offer a special prayer for a very blessed person who's called home rather unexpectedly back to our Lord's kingdom. Please remember the soul of Bishop Milan Shafik, who fell asleep in the Lord very suddenly this past week. Bishop Milan was very well known to many of you. He's been in our church, presumably, right, at some point. I know he's been to many of the churches here in the United States. He's ordained many of the priests that are assisting us. I'm sure he's been here at St. Thomas at one time. He was at my own family's home twice for Holy Supper on Christmas Eve, so we were blessed to have him as well. I'm sure that he's been to many of your homes. He's known and loved by many of you. The Lord called him home far before his time. Bishop Milan's funeral will be this coming week. As a matter of fact, watch the online streaming today from his cathedral in Bukacevo. We have a link up on our parish website and also on our Facebook page. It is a bit early in the wee morning hours, but you could watch reruns of it, I'm sure, if you want to watch it live. Check our website and our Facebook page. You can click on the links, and it will take you to there live, and you can pray along and lift Bishop Milan up in your prayers. If you are unable to do that, please do remember him in your prayers at some point. Bishop Kurt made a statement about him. I wish I could remember it directly, but it's something to the effect that he was, he was really the model bishop, the essential bishop, because he was everywhere. I think he started something like 200 parishes in his home diocese of Bukacevo, our mother eparchy for Byzantine Catholics here in America, and had unlimited and unbelievable energy. So the Lord called him home at the age of, I think, only 67. So please do lift up Bishop Milan in your prayers, and if you could join along with your prayers this afternoon, early this morning, and tomorrow morning, it would be greatly appreciated, okay? Monday is also a holy day. Tomorrow's a holy day, the feast of St. Elias. And St. Elias was taken to heaven how, Adrian? In a fiery chariot. And so we're going to bless our fiery chariots. We also have the custom of blessing cars, our own fiery chariots on the feast of St. Elias. So anybody who comes to church tomorrow, now tomorrow's kind of a special day, not just because it's St. Elias feast day, Bishop Milan's funeral, but it's also the very first time during the week that we will have indoor worship here at St. Thomas. So we will have liturgy tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock, after which those of you who want to have their cars blessed will bless your vehicles. We'll also bless cars next Saturday and next Sunday. We have a very good system here at St. Thomas. You sit in your car and you drive by on that small pad by the school entrance, and we'll sprinkle your car with holy water, very easy. But we'll do that, make that available for you next weekend as well, but certainly also tomorrow. Now, tomorrow, if you do come to church for the holy day, we will also remember Bishop Milan in prayers for his eternal repose, okay? Today, right after liturgy, approximately after liturgy, shortly after liturgy, within about a half an hour or so after liturgy, we'll have our Zoom coffee social, as we do every week. And every week I offer the invitation. Every week there seems to be one more courageous person who decides to join us for coffee. So go home. All you got to do is go home and check your email. And you probably do that a gazillion times a day anyway. So you've got the bulletin waiting in your inbox for email, and you've got a Zoom invitation. Click on the Zoom link, and probably around 11:45 is, I think that's the official start time. We simply gather for a half an hour or so and just get caught up on the day's events. And even if we just do nothing more but look at each other and have a cup of coffee, that's time together. That's kind of important. So I hope that you can join us, okay? Today is not missing. Well, today is the Lord's Day, right? You know, it's always a special day being the Lord's Day, but it's also an anniversary day. It's a natal anniversary. You know what a natal anniversary is, Paul? You know what a natal anniversary is? I'm going to pick on Adrian again. Adrian, what's a natal anniversary?
A natal?
Natal.
Natal.
Natal. Oh, come on.
Someone was born.
Yes, it's a birthday. So it's our campus. Sunday is today. So as she was leading us in prayerful song, let's all stand and we're going to sing for our cantor back. I'm not going to tell you which anniversary of her 39th birthday it is, but it is definitely one of the anniversaries of her 39th birthday today. May God grant her servant, the cantor Patricia, on her birthday, peace, good health, and happiness for many years.
God grant her many years.
High priest servant Bishop Mila, I remember him forever.